This Countess Rostova to marry her, and we're about to elope, is that so?
Monsieur, I don't consider myself bound to answer questions put to me in that tone.
My face already pale becomes distorted by fury. I seize you by the collar with my big, big hands, and I shake you from side to side until your face shows a sufficient degree of terror. When I tell you I must talk to you,
come now, this is stupid. What not, don't.
You're a scoundrel and a blackguard, and I don't know what deprives me of the pleasure of smashing your head in with this. Have you any letters of hers? Any letters? I shan't be violent, don't be afraid. First, the letters. Second, tomorrow you must get out of Moscow.
But how can I?
Third, you must never breathe a word of what has happened between you and the Countess. And now I know I can't prevent your doing. Paces the room several times in silence.
Anatole sits at a table, frowning and biting his lips.
After all, you must understand that besides your pleasure, there's such a thing as other people and their happiness and peace. And that you are ruining a whole life for the sake of amusing yourself. Amuse yourself with women like my wife. With them you're within your rights. But to promise a young girl to marry her, to deceive, to kidnap, why don't you understand that that's as cruel as beating an old man or a child?
Well, I don't know about that, hey. I don't know that, and I don't want to. But you have used such words to me, scoundrel and so on, which as a man of honor, I will not allow anyone to use.
Is it satisfaction you want?
You could at least take back your words, eh? If you want me to do as you wish.
Fine, I take them back. I take them back. And I ask you to forgive me. And if you require money for your journey,
Anatole smiled, the reflection of that base and cringing smile, which Pierre knew so well in his wife, revolted him.
Oh, vile and heartless brute.
Next day, Anatole left for Petersburg.